G'day fellas, and welcome back to Dave's Tank Works. Following on from my recent video clip demonstrating what I have done so far to the Badger, I stated that the next episode would be about the improvements done to the transmission. But in order to avoid confusion, I have decided that it would be best if I continue these episodes in the chronological order in which the Badger was made. So now, in episode 6, I shall demonstrate the construction of the suspension bogies. As you have just seen in action, the suspension bogies is a simple but rugged unit that bolts directly to the hull, with the suspension arms articulated to allow the road wheels to conform to variations in the terrain and obstacles. Shock absorption is provided by a single leaf spring enclosed within the suspension arms. By using leaf springs, which are cheap and readily available, has allowed me to build a simple but very effective suspension unit. So now, let's take a look at how these units were made. The bulk of the materials used is tubular steel that has been cut down to form channels, with the main pieces being cut down from a tube 75 millimetres square with a 3 millimetre wall thickness, which is cut down to form two wedges to the following dimensions. For most of my metal cutting, I prefer to use a good quality 1 millimetre cutting disc fitted to an angle grinder. With practice, you can achieve neat and accurate cuts, but be aware that when cutting along a tube, it will spring inwards and grip the cutting disc, causing considerable damage to the disc and rendering it useless. To prevent this from happening, I either use bolts and nuts or wedges to apply an outwards tension. Now that the wedges have been cut and the jagged edges cleaned up, you're now set to pre-drill all your bolt holes. At this stage, it is essential that you drill the correct piece, which is the smaller of the two wedges. The location of the two half-inch holes must be the same for all the small wedges. In order to achieve this, I have made a drilling jig using a 6 millimeter thick flat bar with side strips welded in place so that the wedge piece can be slid and clamped for accurate drilling. The precise location of the half-inch holes is shown on this drawing. You can now proceed in drilling these two holes only in the small wedge. The third hole in the drilling jig is used to locate a drilling point in a backing plate for the large wedge. As with the drilling jig, this piece is cut from a stock standard 75 millimeter wide flat bar. Prior to welding this piece in place, a half-inch nut is welded to one side. To cap off the small wedge, another piece of channel is cut from 50 millimeter tube with half-inch holes drilled at these locations, after which you can weld these two parts together on the inside of the wedge and also with the large wedge and backing piece, making sure that the edge of the piece is level with the back of the channel. When you do the welding on the smaller wedge, it is important that you leave a break in the welding bead adjacent to the holes so that a nut has sufficient room to be turned and tightened in place. At this stage or prior, you will need to drill a small pilot hole in the center on the back face of the channel. The reason for this will be explained at a later stage. The next step is to align the two wedges in preparation for welding together. To ensure that you get the correct alignment, you will need to make a simple assembly jig from a 6 millimeter flat bar with two half-inch holes to match those of the small wedge and a true squared edge at 33 millimeters from the center of the holes. Use your drilling jig to get the exact location and spacing of the holes. Now firmly bolt the assembly jig in place, then place the large wedge so it's hard up against the jig. The tip of the wedge will overhang slightly, but this can be removed after welding. With the two wedge assemblies now welded together on three seams, that's both sides and the tip, you can now drill a half-inch hole at the location of the pilot hole, then weld an half-inch nut over the hole. Using a bolt to hold the nut firmly in place is recommended for this procedure. The purpose of this nut is to provide an anchor point for the suspension riding height adjuster. This now completes the construction of the suspension mounting bracket, ready for the next step. The construction of the suspension arms is quite simple and straightforward. Basically, it's just a piece of channel with two axle sleeves welded in place. The channel sections are cut from a 40x40x3mm square tube to a length of 220mm with one face cut away. When you've cut your channels, the first thing to do is to mark your drilling points on each face, the first one being 20mm from one end and another 170mm from that point, but is set 30mm in from the back of the channel. At the first point, scribe an arc with a 20mm radius, cut and face back to the line, giving you a neat rounded end. At the other end, cut a truncation in the sides of the channel to the dimensions shown. The next thing to do is to drill through both sides of the channel holes large enough to take your axle sleeves. The round tube that I use has a 17mm outside diameter, which makes it ideal to rebore to half inch to take the axle bolts. As for yourself, these holes will depend on what stock you can acquire. In this drawing, you can see that the axle sleeves are of different lengths, with the sleeve at the rounded end protruding 2mm from each face, whilst at the other end, the sleeves are flush with the faces of the channel. Now you're all set to weld the sleeves in place on the inside of the channel, and also a 3mm flat bar at the square end of the channel, which is required to be welded in place from the outside only. Now it's important to take notice of where the welds are located, as the leaf spring needs to rest against an even surface. And there you have your suspension arms all finished, ready to be fitted into your suspension bracket. For the pivot, I use a 1/2 inch by 3.5 inch high tensile bolt, which will provide sufficient shank to fit inside the sleeve. You have the option to cut the bolt down or leave it to its original length, providing that it is long enough to take a washer and a nylon cord nut. Also, don't forget to give the inside of your sleeve a good coating of grease before the final assembly. But before we do that, we'll need to modify a leaf spring to fit inside the suspension arm. The leaf spring that I have used is of the cold form type, which means that it can be re-bent to conform to my particular requirements. It was 65mm wide, 8mm thick, and approximately 1.4 metres on the circumference. I cut it down the centre, which gave me two lengths at 32mm. I used a 1mm cutting disc with several shallow passes down the length until there was about 1mm left to go, then made the final cut in one pass. Doing it this way prevents the spring steel from overheating and possibly degrade its ductility. Next up is to dock the lengths to 425mm in preparation to have them rebent to a radius of 350mm. To achieve this, I have used a 12-ton hydraulic pipe bender. A 2-inch or 50mm die is used in conjunction with a piece of 6mm flat bar to provide a stable rest and consistent curve for the leaf spring. I've welded tabs to hold the bar in place on the die to prevent it from slipping out. This assembly is now referred to as the convex die, and used in conjunction with this is a concave die, formed from 6mm flat bar with two square tubes welded either end to provide securing points within the pipe bender. The concave die will ensure that the leaf spring is held firmly in place against the convex die. The dies are now ready to be installed and secured within the pipe bender, ready to begin bending the leaf springs to the required curve. Ensuring that the leaf spring is placed centrally between the dies, you're all set to go. In order to check that you got the correct curve, I recommend using a template. You can now go ahead and insert the leaf spring into the suspension arm, so the end of it rests underneath the axle sleeve, but on top of the pivot sleeve. A gap of 12mm either end of the spring is required for it to give it room when it elongates under load. Now slide the other suspension arm over the leaf spring, then insert the other pivot bolt and secure with nylon core nuts, but not too tight as you want the arms to move freely. For the road wheels, I have used a 200mm diameter solid rubber tyred with a one-piece nylon hub with a half-inch bore. Generally, I no longer use nylon hubs, as they tend to bow outwards under the lateral forces imparted by the track guide tooth while slewing or turning the tank. Also, they do not hold a painted surface all that well. To overcome these problems, I have made up steel discs that will fit both sides of each road wheel. The discs are of different thickness and diameter, with the outer disc cut from 1mm sheet steel, with a half-inch centre hole and four anchor points at a radius of 45mm. The inner disc is made from plate steel with a slightly larger diameter, also with four anchor points. These four holes will need to be countersunk. This disc is also beveled to approximately 1.5mm. The reason for the thicker disc on the inner side of the road wheels is to prevent the rubber tyres from gripping the track guide and riding up over it, which could cause shedding of the tracks. By having metal-to-metal contact, the road wheel will slide past the track guide teeth. For fixing the discs to the road wheels, you have the options of either bolting right through the hub or screwing them in place. If you choose to screw them in place, make certain that the screws do not foul each other by rotating one plate 45 degrees to the other by marking the wheel to align the disc holes. Depending on the type of hub, you may have to use a spacer to prevent the thinner outer disc from warping when anchored in place. I recommend drilling a pilot hole into the hub so the points of the screws do not drift off perpendicular. For the outer disc, I've used a hex head screw to add a bit of feature. For the inner disc, a long thread countersunk screw is required. For the wheel axles, I've used a 7-inch by 1/2-inch high tensile bolt with spacing washers on the inside of the wheel to give a 46mm gap between the wheels. A nylon cord nut is fitted just loose enough to allow the wheels to spin freely. Now you have the suspension bogies ready to be bolted to the hull, when I will demonstrate the fixing and the procedure for adjusting the height and camber of the suspension bogies. So there you go, fellas. Until the next episode, all the best of luck in building your scaled tank.